And welcome back to Let's Play Mass Effect 2 Blind. I'm the RPG chick. One of two things will happen in this video. I've been told that I will not be able to get to the galaxy map until I speak to the collective man. At which point I may be dragged off on another mission. Oh, that wasn't really spelled out for me, but that's what I figure is going to happen. Well, I'm going to try to go to the galaxy map. If I can do so, then we'll be doing Miranda's loyalty mission. If not, I will read Codex entries for this episode as I need to catch up with them. And as a way of protest and putting off the elusive man
man wishes to speak to you in the debriefing room, Commander.
Yes, we are well aware of that.
Change of plans, Commander. Urgent message coming in from the elusive man.
Oh, he was right. Thank you so much. I can't remember the name, followed by the number 1976 or 1978, I believe. Thank you for the heads up and the very excellent non-spoilery tip. It's back on the episode. I don't know the number, but it's called Trapped Workers and Windy Bridges. If you guys want to know how to leave me a tip without spoiling things, pretty much follow letter for letter what this guy did. And, oh, that's the Arkiev, 1976 or 19, I believe it's 1976. So, yeah, follow, learn from what he did. Most excellent. Asking questions first. Very giving minimal information with warnings and such. Very good, very good. I commend him. So, I'm going to read Codex entries. We're going to talk to Elusive Man next episode, in which case we're probably going to be dragged away somewhere for a little while. And from what I understand, we'll be able to come back and do everything else that we want to do after that. But since that's inevitably going to be a lot of action, and we just came out of a lot of action. Well, last episode was pretty much, what do you call it? Just talking to the crew. Gonna feed the fishies. Change the music. Something a little less action-y. I'm probably gonna choose... Yes. That one. So yeah, Codex entries this time. Let's see how far we can get. I know there've been some added, but I don't think there's that many. We haven't got to them in quite a while. Okay, so we have some primary. Okay, so these are read for us.
In the early 2160s, the Krogan, hovering tanks resembling a cross between an octopus and a giant crab. Praetorians are well-armored killing machines of mysterious origin. Praetorians employ redundant systems from the multiple humans encased within them. Armed with eye-mounted particle beams and capable of attacks at close range, they teleport to evade attack while regenerating their shields. Within hours after death, the organic components of Praetorian corpses disintegrate into a denatured pus, while their mechanisms turn to ash. One specimen, autopsied within minutes of death, reveals a clue. Nanomachines may disintegrate the Praetorians' organic and mechanical components before self-destructing. If correct, this self-rendering hypothesis could account for three documented cases of dead Praetorians apparently releasing, or becoming, clouds of neurotoxic gases, causing suffocating paralysis and nearly instant death. In one remote facility, 17 soldiers died from gas inhalation while assessing the Praetorian. Any personnel in the vicinity of dead Praetorians are urged to protect themselves with breathing apparatus.
Huh. So they... Okay. It's a toxic gas. I guess it's good that I normally fight from so far... You know, far away from these guys. Otherwise it might have affected me. because I didn't notice anything at the time. It's kind of ironic, actually, that our first entry is this one, because the last time I talked to the elusive man, he dragged me off on Horizon. We ended up fighting a bunch of collectors and these bad boys. So, inevitably facing something like that again.
Okay. Although they...
Nope. Next one is planets and locations.
Freedom's Progress Horizon. Colony, a typical Terminus colony possessing minimal tourist value. Horizon promises substantial economic opportunity, especially in providing new products for humans and supplying the Turian hierarchy. Surveyed 18 years ago, Horizon received pilot habitation 4 years later. The colony proper is now 8 years old. Blessed with verdant forests and abundant fresh water, Horizon maintains a colonial culture that thrives as a refuge from the increasing restrictions of Citadel-governed society. Horizon has attracted numerous dissidents, marginal people, and fringe dwellers from across Alliance space.
Yep, and a lot of them were kidnapped by collectors. Ilium?
A regional hub of Asari commerce awash in riches, Ilium is infamous for its abusive labor practices and legalization of nearly everything except murder. As such, Ilium is the preferred production site for weapons and pharmaceuticals that would be illegal nearly everywhere else, made even more lucrative by legal indentured servitude. Among the biotics-related pharmaceutical producers is the Dantius Corporation, a rising star in galactic commerce.
Just attack their towers.
Despite the dangers of its products, Ilium is renowned for glamour, luxury, and safety, provided by near-total surveillance, making it a favored tourist destination. Countless celebrities maintain palatial estates on Ilium and in its capital, Nos Astra. The sole obstacle to business on Ilium is its extensive bureaucracy, tolerated only for its provision of security. Regardless of the character of its economy, Ilium's self-congratulatory media exalts its own society with the provincial arrogance of new money, glorifying in sexiest CEOs and 10 richest residents lists.
Sounds familiar. Now, remind me of this. What this Rakana is.
Originally an asteroid, the Drell homeworld of Rakana once teemed with life. Its arid plains home to spectacular insect and reptile analogs. But the Drell took to industrialization early and did not realize the extent of the environmental damage they caused until it was too late. Their topsoil depleted and oceans too acidic to sustain life, the Drell were situated for a massive population crash by 2025 CE. It was then the Hanar stepped in, mounting a large-scale rescue operation to bring Drell to the Hanar homeworld, Kaje. As wars erupted over what resources remained on Rakana and billions began to die, approximately 375,000 Drell escaped in the exodus. To repay their debt, the Drell entered into an agreement with the Hanar. Called the Compact, it states that the Drell would assist the Hanar with tasks the Hanar cannot physically perform. Today, high-ranking Hanar are frequently inseparable from their Drell attendants.
That's actually really fascinating. I'm looking forward to finding out more, if possible, the relationship between the Hanar and the Drell. Pretty unique. Weapons, armor, and equipment. This always pops up here.
The collector's Avalanche. Particle beam, still in its experimental stages, the M622 Avalanche generates a Bose-Einstein condensate within a mass effect bubble, which dissipates on impact, violently spraying the condensate outward and coating the target in a near absolute zero superfluid. The Avalanche is unreliable, at times merely coating its target with ice, defacing exposed skin and freezing armor joints. Such low temperatures cause great damage to electronics like kinetic barrier emitters, which sometimes leads to total systems failure. At the other extreme, the Avalanche freezes flesh and bone, causing massive trauma as blood vessels constrict and frozen blood expands. Occasionally, such ice tissue shatters.
Ouch. Okay. My turn. Non-council races. Drell, biology. Or it could be... No, I don't... See, that the first one always gets red. So I'm pretty sure this one's new too, because all the Horizon stuff was new. That's how long it's been since we looked at the Codex, guys, since before Horizon. So read about the Collector General. Pretty sure I don't know about this. Cerberus xenobiologists believed until recently that the Collectors were coordinated by a biotically active caste, similar to other insectoid alien species. New evidence suggests the Collectors have a singular commander, a so-called Collector General, that has never been seen on the battlefield. Instead, it selects its minions as remote platforms for its consciousness in a process that has been likened to a biological hack or a cybernetic version of demonic possession. The Collector General can send a secure signal to any one of its minions, smoothly take control of their motor functions, and awaken their previously dormant bionic potential. In a matter of seconds, even the lowliest Collector drone can be upgraded to a battle-hardened bionic commander. If the Collector dies, the General can simply activate and control another body. Postmortem analysis reveals that this command signal relies on cybernetic implants directly installed in the Collector's cerebellums, but how the technology functions is presently unknown. Coordinating sensory input and motor functions simultaneous with remotely amplifying biotic abilities is beyond the grasp of current human science. Why such an advanced species would be interested in humans is puzzling. More disturbing still, victims of the Collectors say the General has spoken to them and referred to itself by a human name, Harbinger. So it's the Collector General and a Harbinger. Okay, Drell biology. Drell are omnivorous, reptile-like humanoids with an average lifespan of 85 galactic standard years. They give live birth to their young, who are capable of eating solid food from the moment they are born. It's interesting, because reptiles actually, they lay eggs. Drell appearance is very similar to Asarian humans, but their muscle tissue is slightly denser than that of humans, giving them a wiry strength. Many of their more reptilian features are concealed, like a three-chambered heart with a muscular ridge that is capable of shunting oxygenated or deoxygenated blood as needed. One unique characteristic, however, is the hyoid bone in their throats, which allows them to inflate their throats and produce vocal sounds outside of the human range. Would-be assassins have noted that these two features make Drell extremely hard to strangle or suffocate. Well, that's pretty cool. Because the Drell ancestors emerged from arid, rocky deserts, the humid, ocean-covered Hanar homeworld of Kajay proved tolerable only when the Drell stayed inside a climate-controlled dome city. Due to this huge disparity in the two species' homeworld environments, the leading cause of death among Drells on Kajay is a bacterial lung disease called Kepler's syndrome. Yes, that's what our friend Thane Krios has. Within a generation of the Drell's arrival on the planet, the disease had become resistant to Hanar antibiotics and other advanced treatments. Once an infection settles in, death is slow but imminent. Transplants may buy time, but as the infection spreads to other major organs, there comes a point of diminishing returns and eventual system failure. So sad. Anything new here? Nope, that's it for non-council races. Non-sapient creatures? We know we've read about Hasasions. Though the exact fate of species captured by the Collectors is unclear, the humanoid appearance of the Scions gives ghastly clues. The Scion's frame and skull are similar to those of a human or a Sari, but the bone structure is overlaid with a metallic resin. Posthumous examination of their bodies reveals a skin tone resembling that of Reaper husks, but their transformation seems more extensive. Like husks, they are cybernetically modified on a nanoscale so they can operate even in hard vacuum. Hoses rather than veins and muscle tissue join major portions of the body together. One arm is replaced with a construct that fits a large rifle, turning the creature into a humanoid weapons platform, and a fleshy sack is supported by the creature's back and head. These sacks contain brain matter and spinal tissue, too much to have come from just one victim. This indicates scions are an amalgam of several individuals, with one primary victim providing the frame and several secondaries providing the flesh for a decentralized, semi-mechanical nervous system. This decentralization makes them highly resistant to gunshot wounds. Even a headshot is not a certain kill. The scion's weapons, however, indicate that scions retain some living tissue, or at least sustain some of the same electrochemical reactions as those of a human biotic. The weapon creates a powerful warp effect, which is consistent with the ESO nodules visible in the scion's expansive nervous system. Given the rarity of human biotics, it seems likely that these dust-form ESO nodules are deposited during their transformation, rather than requiring a biotic victim in the first place. The Reaper's Secrets Arrival. Planet Eratot. Nothing is impossible, says the hegemony propaganda poster that depicts a muscular Batarian miner under an Eratot sky, his rebreather held away from his face as if he's just taken it off. The image sums up millions of man-hours of labor on the Batarian planet and represents, or misrepresents, much of its history. 2 decades ago, Eratot, like several planets in the Skillian Verge, was claimed by both human and Batarian governments, but the Alliance backed out after learning about the atmosphere's dangerously low pressure and oxygen levels. Instead, they concentrated their colonial efforts on planets that could support human life without the aid of domed habitats and rebreathers. Human governments saw it as a wise move, Batarians saw it as cowardly. The Batarians rose to the colonization challenge, shipping in large numbers of laborers. They took the high financial costs and casualties due to accidents or logistical snafus in stride. Large-scale dumping of cyanobacteria has increased the oxygen in the atmosphere by a fraction of 1%, a modest increase that the hegemony trumpets as a sign of their eventual victory. Short-term profits on Eratot are largely made in the minerals sector through mining the extremely metal-rich planetary crust. The dark side to the mining does not appear on the propaganda poster. The majority of laborers are indentured servants or slaves. Eratot is rumored to have military bases on its surface and throughout its solar system, though details are heavily restricted by the hegemony's Ministry of Information Control. HMIC? Human merchant ships rarely come to the planet outcompeted by local companies that benefit from heavy economic protection. The average Eratot citizen only sees humans on the news, usually featured in stories of trials and executions of accused spies. Plants and locations are next. Let me just change the music really quick, since I know it's supposed to get repetitive. It is repetitive. I just don't need something so energetic. And that really wouldn't fit either. I guess we turn it off. Sure. Planets and locations. I'm pretty sure you read about Ilos. Purgatory. Originally an ark ship designed to carry agricultural animals, the Purgatory was taken by the Blue Sun's mercenary company during a large-scale battle in the Skillian Verge. In a years-long reconstruction of its interior, the Blue Suns repurposed it to hold sapient prisoners, supposedly because they captured so many in their conflicts throughout the galaxy. When media outlets started investigating claims that the ship was used for slaving operations, the Blue Suns turned a public relations nightmare into a regular income source. Claiming to be in full accordance with Citadel law, the crew of Purgatory now regularly lands on planets or space stations, claiming that they can no longer hold their prisoners because of cost overruns. To avoid keeping prisoners under inhumane conditions, they will have to release them at the nearest port, dumping the scum of the galaxy directly into the local population. Faced with such a scenario, the government usually grants Purgatory's crew massive discounts in fuel, food, and repairs as long as they go away. So, hold on a second, guys. Some even offload their own prisoners to Purgatory for a fee, grateful to have a problem relocated somewhere other than their backyard. Such unfortunates go in the dark depths of the ship, never to be seen again by their families or contacts. Purgatory is minimally armed with Guardian defenses. Though a cruiser weight ship, it relies on the Blue Sun's fighters to prevent any attacks bent on a jailbreak or similar events. Well, we kind of messed them up a little, didn't we? In our escape with Jack. This is like, I can't believe it's been that this long. I mean, this seems like such old stuff to me that we're reading about. Shadow Games, The Broker's Secrets. The Yogg. The Yogg are a race of massive apex predators from the world of Parnak, whose rise to sentience in no way blunted their violent nature. A group of Yogg is unable to cooperate until a single leader has been determined through either social maneuvering or brute force, but no grudges are held once a Yogg establishes dominance. Former rivals serve the new superior's purpose with unflinching loyalty and relentless determination, a legacy of their origin as pack species. Their eight eyes are another sign of their hunter ancestry. Or all four pairs are geared towards tracking down and predicting the movements of prey. Sophisticated and keenly developed sensitivity to movement and light have made Yogg's masters at reading body language, regardless of species. Much to the short-lived chagrin, the Council's first contact teams discovered it was nearly impossible to lie to the Yogg. The Yogg had technology equivalent to 20th century Earth standards when they were discovered by the Council in 2125. The Council's ambassadors approached the Yogg as friends and allies instead of subordinates, a baffling sign of contempt from newcomers on Parnak. The Yogg attacked when it became apparent that the alien diplomats stubbornly considered themselves sovereign people instead of new underlings. Parnak remains off-limits by order of the Council, which fears that the Yogg's size, aggression, and obsession with control make them poorly suited for integration into the galactic community. I think they have a right to be concerned there. Ships and vehicles. A lot. I'm pretty sure we haven't read this entire thing. So I'm going to read about the A-61 Mantis gunship. And all the other crap. The workhorse of mercenary bands throughout the galaxy, the Mantis is a two-man vector thrust aircraft that excels in close air support roles. Highly modular in construction, the Mantis can be reconfigured as a low-altitude gunship, a fighter, a high-altitude bomber, or even a single-stage-to-orbit space plane that can engage enemy craft around a planet or space station. The only role that the Mantis cannot perform is that of a true deep space fighter, as it has no FTL drive. First rolled off the assembly lines in 2170, the Mantis remains in service in dozens of armies across the galaxy. It is most commonly used as air support in pitched ground battles, in a configuration that sports two pods for Inferno PKR's precision kill rockets and a chin-mounted M350 mass accelerator cannon. Its kinetic barriers, thermal decoy system, and electronic countermeasures suite make the Mantis far less vulnerable to surface-to-air attacks than the previous generations of aircraft. Like most modern planes, the Mantis uses an Element Zero core to ease the load of the engines with a mass effect field, allowing it to take off vertically or hover in space using minimum fuel. This also gives it far greater range and speed than the helicopters and jump jet aircraft that once filled its niche. A Mantis can take off from Baton Rouge, reach Moscow in a few hours, fly a ground attack mission, and return home before having to refuel. I'm just going to change the music because it gets a little loud at points. Do this one. Stop our journal. Go to Citadel, Fathine, go to Garrus. Oh yeah, I gotta do this too. They won't let me go to the map though. I return to Ilium. For this, and this. Oh yeah, we finished this. It still says new. Okay, it should stop now. Good. Squad. Oh. Yeah, I said I was gonna take pole next. People wanted, let me see. If I get back to the codex here. My little notes. As far as I can tell, two people said pole, two people said incendiary ammo, and two people said assault mastery. So I'm pretty sure after taking shockwave, that's when I asked you guys, and I took assault mastery after that. I'm gonna take pole now, and I'll take incendiary ammo next time. You guys are tired, sorry. heavy pole or pole field. I like pull field. So I'm gonna take pull field and do that. Cool. Alright. Now more ships and vehicles. FTL drive. Faster than light drives use element zero cores to reduce the mass of the ship, allowing higher rates of acceleration. This effectively raises the speed of light within the mass effect field, allowing high speed travel with negligible relativistic time dilation effects. Starships still require conventional thrusters, chemical rockets, commercial fusion torch, economy ion engine, or military anti-proton drive, in addition to the FTL drive core. With only a core, a ship has no motive power. The amount of ESO and power required for a drive increases exponentially to the mass being moved and the degree it is being lightened. Very massive ships or very high speeds are prohibitively expensive. If the field collapses while the ship is moving at faster than light speed, the effects are catastrophic. The ship is snapped back to sublight velocity. The enormous excess energy shed in the form of lethal Cherenkov radiation. That does not sound good. FTL drive appearance. New space travelers ask, what does it look like outside a ship moving at faster than light speed? Part of the answer can be seen in the simple pane of glass. Light travels slower through glass than it does through open air. Light also moves slower in conventional space than it does in a high-speed mass effect field. This causes refraction. Any light entering at an angle is bent and separated into a spectrum. Objects outside the ship will appear refracted. The greater the difference between the objective exterior and subjective interior speeds of light, the greater the refraction. As the subjective speed of light is raised within the field, objects outside will appear to redshift, eventually becoming visible only to radio telescope antenna. High-energy electromagnetic sources normally hidden to the eye become visible in the high blue spectrum. As the speed of light continues to be raised, X-ray, gamma ray, and eventually cosmic ray sources become visible. Stars will be replaced by pulsars, the accretion disks of black holes, quasars, and gamma ray bursts. To an outside observer, a ship within a mass effect drive envelope appears blue shifted. If within a field that allows travel at twice the speed of light, any radiation it emits has twice the energy as normal. If the ship is in a field of about 200 times light speed, it radiates visible light as X-rays and gamma rays, and the infrared heat from the hull is blue shifted up into the visible spectrum or higher. Ships moving at FTL are visible at great distances, though their signature will only propagate at the speed of light. Okay, I'm sorry guys, with this part of the... Evolve any power? I got an achievement by reading the Codex about evolving power. Alright, next. That was a little too energetic, that part. I'll just mess around with it till we get a good one. FTL drive, drive, charge. As positive or negative electric current is passed through an FTL drive core, it acquires a static electrical charge. Drives can be operated an average of 50 hours before they reach charge saturation. This change is proportional to the magnitude of mass reduction. A heavier or faster ship reaches saturation more quickly. If the charge is allowed to build, the crew would discharge into the hull... Sorry, the core. That would be painful. The core will discharge into the hull of a ship. All ungrounded crew members are fried to a crisp. Still painful. All electronic systems are burned out and metal bulkheads may be melted and fused together. The safest way to discharge a core is to land on a planet and establish a connection to the ground, like a lightning rod. Larger vessels like dreadnoughts cannot land and must discharge into a planetary magnetic field. The ship passes the charge from the drive core to the exterior armored hull, then dives into the magnetic field. As the hull discharges, sheets of lightning jump away into the field, creating beautiful auroral displays on the planet. The ship must retract its sensors and weapons while dumping charge to prevent damage, leaving it blind and helpless. Discharging at a moon with a weak magnetic field can take days. Discharging into the powerful field of a gas giant may require less than an hour. Deep space facilities such as Citadel often have special discharge facilities for visiting ships. Helios Thruster Module. Intended for next-generation fighter craft, the Heed Industries Helios Thruster Module propulsion system far outpaces the typical liquid-hydrogen-liquid oxygen reactions that power a frigate's maneuvering thrusters. By using metastable metallic hydrogen, the Helios boasts a fuel that burns at far greater efficiency than liquid H2O2. Navigators can execute the numerous small course corrections inherent to any long-distance travel without fear of exhausting the ship's fuel supplies. This net gain extends to forward impulse as well. A ship powered by antiprotons can coast temporarily using the Helios to reach an inferior but highly sustainable speed. Such efficiency lowers antiproton consumption, a constant concern for any warship. Okay, I need a drink. When a Helios-propelled ship must refuel, however, it typically relies on a large carrier or nearby planetary factory to synthesize the metallic hydrogen. This process uses extremely dense mass effect fields to create the metal under pressures of over a million Earth atmospheres, an activity most safely done while planetside. While that process may seem like a drawback compared to skimmer ships that can gather hydrogen and oxygen from anywhere in the universe, the combat superiority of the Helios' maneuvering capabilities is often a worthwhile trade-off. The same efficiency that allows for microburn correction course correction can power rapid bursts of motion. Once a pilot becomes used to the ship's new energetic responses, she can easily put the ship wherever and at whatever angle she desires. Space combat, combat endurance. Heat limits the length and intensity of ship-to-ship combat. Starships generate enormous heat when they fire high-energy weapons, perform maneuvering burns, and run onboard combat electronics. In combat, warships produce heat more quickly than they can disperse it. As heat builds within a vessel, the crewed spaces become increasingly uncomfortable. Before the heat reaches lethal levels, a ship must win or retreat by entering FTL. After an FTL run, the ship halts, shuts down non-essential systems, and activates the heat radiation gear. Combat endurance varies by ship design and by the battle's location. Battles in the deep cold of interstellar space can go on for some time. Engagements close to a star are brief. Since habitable worlds are usually close to a star, battles over them are frantic. Space combat, general tactics. Shells lofted by surface navies crash back to Earth when their acceleration is overwhelmed by gravity and air resistance. In space, a projectile has unlimited range. It will keep moving until it hits something. Practical gunnery range is determined by the velocity of the attacker's ordnance and the maneuverability of the target. Beyond a certain range, a small ship's ability to dodge trumps a larger attacker's projectile speed. The longest range combat occurs between dreadnoughts, whose projectiles have the highest velocity but are the least maneuverable. The shortest range combat is between frigates, which have the slowest projectile velocities and highest maneuverability. Opposing dreadnoughts open with a main gun artillery duel at extreme ranges of tens of thousands of kilometers. The fleets close, maintaining evasive lateral motion while keeping their bow guns facing the enemy. Fighters are launched and attempt to close to disruptor torpedo range. Cautious admirals weaken the enemy with ranged fire and fighter strikes before committing to close action. Aggressive commanders advance so cruisers and frigates can engage. At long range, the main guns of cruisers become useful. Friendly interceptors engage enemy fighters until the attackers enter the range of ship-based guardian fire. Dreadnoughts fire from the rear, screened by smaller ships. Commanders must decide whether to commit to a general melee or retreat into FTL. At medium range, ships can use broadside guns. Fleets intermingle and it becomes difficult to retreat in order. Ships with damaged kinetic barriers are vulnerable to wolf pack frigate flotillas that speed through the battle space. Only fighters and frigates enter close knife fight ranges of 10 or fewer kilometers. Fighters loose their disruptor torpedoes, bringing down a ship's kinetic barriers and allowing it to be swarmed by frigates. Guardian lasers become viable weapons, swatting down fighters and boiling away warship armor. Neither dreadnoughts nor cruisers can use their main guns at close range. Laying the bow on a moving target becomes impossible. Superheated thruster exhaust becomes a hazard. Space combat, planetary assaults. Planetary assaults are complicated if the target is a habitable garden world. The attackers cannot approach the defenders straight on. The Citadel Conventions prohibit the use of large kinetic impactors against habitable worlds. In a straight-on attack, any misses plow into the planet behind the defending fleet. If the defenders position themselves between the attackers and the planet, they can fire at will while the attacker risks hitting the planet. Successful attacks on garden worlds will hinge upon up-to-date intelligence. Attackers need to determine where the enemy's defenses are, so they may approach them from an angle that allows them to fire at will with no danger of collateral damage. Note that this is not necessary for hostile worlds. Once control of orbit has been lost, defensive garrisons disperse into the wilderness. An enemy with orbital superiority can bombard service forces with impunity. The best option for defenders is to hide and collect reconnaissance in anticipation of relief forces. Given the size of a planet, it is impractical to garrison entire conquered worlds. Fortunately, colonization efforts tend to focus on building up a dozen or fewer areas. Ground forces occupy the spaceports, industrial facilities, and major population centers. The wilderness is patrolled by unmanned aerial vehicles and satellite reconnaissance. If a defender unit is spotted, air mobile, rapid deployment, units, and satellite artillery are used to pin down and destroy them. Gotta change the music. Isn't this where we were? I'm not sure. Do we have this one already? No, I don't think so. Similar, but not the same. I still have other stuff. Okay, space combat, trans relay assaults. The crucial choice for any attack through mass relays is how to divide the fleet for transit. The accuracy of a relay's mass projection depends on the mass being moved and how far it's going. Any long distance and or high mass jump will see drift. That is, a ship may be hundreds or millions of kilometers from its intended drop point in any direction from the relay. Distance can't be chosen by admirals, but a relay is told how much mass to transit. For example, if told to move 1 million metric tons of mass, the relay will scan the approach corridor, find four 250,000-ton freighters, and transit them together, maintaining their relative positions. A commander has the option of moving his fleet as one large, coherent formation that may be wildly off position, or breaking it up into many smaller formations that will be individually closer to the intended attack point, but could be wildly dispersed. Conservative assault doctrine holds that fleets should be moved en masse, maintaining concentration of force and reducing the chances of collision. The only time it is reasonable to split up a formation is during blockade running. Drink. Starships. Carriers. All races provide their fleets with organic fighter support. Cruisers fit a handful in the space between the interior pressure hulls and exterior armor. Dreadnoughts have a hangar deck within the hull. Humans, who had only recently graduated from surface to space combat, were the first to build ships wielding freighters as the main armament. In fleet combat, carriers stay clear of battle, launching fighters bearing disruptor torpedoes. Fighters are the primary striking power of the ship. If a carrier enters mass accelerator range of the enemy, things have gone very wrong. It is possible to recover and rearm fighters during combat, though most carriers seal the flight deck and try to stay out of the way. The flight deck is essentially a corridor through the armor and into the heart of the vessel. A single well-placed torpedo is enough to gut a carrier. Alliance carriers are named after great leaders, artists, and intellectuals from human history. Starships, crew considerations. Cabins give each individual 10 cubic meters of space. On larger vessels, private rooms are common. As ships get smaller, the number of crew packed into a single wardroom increases. Asari prefers shared spaces even on large vessels, while Krogan territorial instincts make it impossible for them to cohabitate even on the smallest ships. On smaller vessels, hot bunking is the norm. Crew members assigned to different watches share the same bunk. When one gets off duty, he wakes up the person in his bunk. While that crewman is on duty, the first gets his rack time. Spacecraft compartments can be isolated by airtight doors in case of decompression. The cinematic vision of explosive decompression is fiction. Hold compartments either take enough damage that occupants are killed instantly, or leak slowly enough that they are able to reach protective gear. Compartments are equipped with emergency life support apparatus, ELSA, fireproof plastic bubbles with air bottles. Small when stowed, ELSA comfortably accommodates one individual when inflated. Damage control procedure cuts off ventilation to burning compartments. Without oxygen to consume, fires die in seconds. The compartment is repressurized afterwards for crew recovery. Mass effect fields create an artificial gravity A-grav plane below the decks, preventing muscle atrophy and bone loss in zero-G. Large vessels arrange their decks perpendicular to their thrust axis. The highest decks are at the bow and the lowest at the engines. This allows A-grav to work with the inertial effects of thrust. Ships that can land arrange their decks laterally so the crew can move about while the vessel is on the ground. Need another drink. Oh, my voice is messed up today. Warships normally turn off their A-grav systems during combat, reducing the heat generated by systems and increasing combat endurance. To provide a point of reference for navigating in zero-G, floors are painted a different color from the walls and ceilings. Huh, that's actually a really good idea. Starships, cruisers. Cruiser-weight starships are the standard combat unit encountered away from large naval bases, the poor, bloody infantry of most fleets. Nimble scouting frigates have neither the punch nor the stamina to stand up to serious combat, and the mighty dreadnoughts are a strategic resource, carefully hoarded and committed to the most critical battles. Hold on a second. Cruisers perform routine independent show-the-flag patrols in settled systems and lead flotillas of frigates in small engagements, such as pirate suppression campaigns. In major fleet engagements, cruiser squadrons support the dreadnought battle line by screening their flanks against enemies attempting to maneuver for a main gun bow shot from their vulnerable broadsides. Alliance cruisers are named after the cities of Earth. Starships. Dreadnoughts. The ultimate arbiter of space warfare, the Dreadnought employs millions of tons of metal, ceramic, and polymer in the projection of firepower against an enemy vessel of like ability. No sane commander would face a Dreadnought without a Dreadnought of his or her own. A Dreadnought's power lies in the length of its main gun. Dreadnoughts range from 800 meters to 1 kilometer long, with main guns of commensurate length. An 800-meter mass accelerator is capable of accelerating one 20-kilogram slug to a velocity of 4,025 kilometers every 2 seconds, which is 1.3% of light speed. Each slug has the kinetic energy of 38 kilotons of TNT, enough to destroy the infrastructure of a mid-sized city and kill 500,000 people. Wow. Because of air friction, planets with atmospheres do not feel a slug's full devastation. Atmospheric drag reduces impact force by 20% per Earth atmosphere of air. At present, the Turian fleet possesses 39 dreadnoughts, the Asari 20, and the Salarian 16. Each of the Human Alliance's 8 dreadnoughts is named for terrestrial mountains. Everest class, Everest, Fuji, and Elbrus. Kilimanjaro class, Kilimanjaro, Taishan, Shasta, Aconcagua, Orizaba. Starships, fighters. Fighters are a single-pilot combat small craft. They are lightweight enough that they can be economically fitted with powerful Element Zero cores, making them capable of greater acceleration and sharper maneuvers than starships. Kinetic barrier shields change starship battles from short, vicious bloodbaths to extended, indecisive slugging matches. Only the main gun of a dreadnought could punch a mass accelerator slug through the barriers of an opposing dreadnought. This changed with the development of the fighter-launched mass disruptor torpedo, a short-range weapon that can penetrate kinetic barriers to destroy their projector assemblies. Starship guardian defenses must be overwhelmed through swarm tactics. Fighter groups can take heavy casualties, pressing their torpedo attacks home. Once fighter-launched torpedoes have crippled an enemy's barriers, the mass accelerators on frigates and cruisers can make short work of them. Interceptors are a type of fighter optimized to attack other fighters with no ability to damage starships. Interceptors are used to screen friendly units from incoming fighter attack. Long episode, guys. Gonna skip technology and the other stuff, weapons and stuff, and I'm just gonna finish starships. I hope we're getting sorta near the end. Starships, frigates. Frigates are light escorts and scouts, often possessing extensive guardian systems, providing anti-fighter screening for capital ships, and crewed with a squad of marines for security and groundside duty. Unlike larger vessels, frigates can land on planets. The most important role filled by frigates is reconnaissance. Sensors, unlike ships and communications employing the mass effect, are limited to the speed of light. Therefore, a stationary observer can detect a vessel a light year away only when its light arrives a year later. Because faster than light attackers always arrive before defenders can detect them with luminal sensors, attackers can always surprise defenders. For defense, fleets surround themselves with spheres of scouting frigates, scanning for enemy ships and transmitting warnings to the main body. Frigates achieve high FTL cruise speeds because of their high-performance drives. They also have proportionally larger thrusters and lighter design mass, allowing them greater maneuverability. In combat, speed and maneuverability make frigates immune to long-range fire of larger vessels. In fleet combat, frigates are organized into wolfpack flotillas of 4-6. Wolfpacks speed through enemy formations, hunting enemy vessels whose kinetic barriers have been taken down by fighter-launched disruptor torpedoes. Wolfpacks circle strafes vulnerable targets. Wolfpacks circle strafe vulnerable targets using superior speed and maneuverability to evade return fire. Alliance frigates are named for great battles in human history. Storming the beach at Normandy? Like the Normandy. Right. Got it! Starships. Heat management. Dispersal of heat generated by onboard systems is a critical issue for a ship. If it cannot deal with the heat, the crew may be cooked within the hull. Yummy. Radiation is the only way to shed heat in a vacuum. Civilian vessels utilize large, fragile radiator panels that are impossible to armor. Warships use diffuse radiator arrays, DRA, ceramic strips along the exterior of the armored hull. These make the ship appear striped to thermographic sensors. Since the arrangement of the strips depends on the internal configuration of the ship, the patterns for each vessel are unique and striking. On older ships, the DRA strips can become red or white hot. Dubbed tiger stripes or war paint by humans, the glowing DRA had a psychological impact on pirates and irregular forces. Strip radiators are not as efficient as panels, but if damaged by enemy fire, the ship only loses a small portion of its total radiation capacity. In most cases, a vessel's DRA alone allows it to cruise with no difficulties. Operations deep within a solar system can cause problems. A ship engaged in combat can produce titanic amounts of heat from maneuvering burns and weapons fire. When fighting in a high heat environment, warships employ high efficiency droplet heat sinks. In a droplet system, tanks of liquid sodium or lithium absorb heat within the ship. The liquid is vented from spray nozzles near the bow as a thin sheet of millions of micrometer scale droplets. The droplets are caught at the stem and recycled into the system. A droplet system can sink 10 to 100 times as much heat as DRA strips. Droplet sheets resemble a surface ship's wake through the water. The wake peels out in sharp turns, spreading a fan of droplets as the ship changes vectors and leaves the coolant behind. Is it? Because it says here they're caught and recycled into the system. So why would we have a wake of it? Why would we have a wake of droplets if it's catching it at the stern and recycling into the system? Just a little confused on that. As Spark would say, starships, sensors. Light lag prevents sensing in real time at great distances. A ship firing its thrusters at the Charon relay can be easily detected from Earth 5.75 light years, 6 billion kilometers away, but Earth will only see the event 5 hours and 45 minutes after it occurs. Due to the light speed limit, defenders can't see enemies coming until they have already arrived. Because there is FTL travel and communications, but no FTL sensors, frigates are crucial for scouting and picket duties. Passive sensors are used for long-range detection, while active sensors obtain short-range, high-quality targeting data. Passive sensors include visual, thermographic, and radio detectors that watch and listen for objects in space. A powered ship emits a great deal of energy. The heat of the life support systems, the radiation given off by power plants and electrical equipment, and the exhaust of the thrusters. Starships stand out plainly against the near absolute zero background of space. Passive sensors can be used during FTL travel, but incoming data is significantly distorted by the effects of the Mass Effect envelope and Doppler shift. Active sensors are radars and high-resolution LADARs, laser detection and ranging, that emit a ping of energy and listen for return signals. LADARs have a narrower field of view than radar, but LADAR resolution allows images of detected objects to be assembled. Active sensors are useless when a ship is moving at FTL speeds. Oh, God. I'm guessing weapons are the last. Starships, thrusters. A Mass Effect drive core decreases the mass of a bubble of space-time around a ship. This gives the ship the potential to move quickly, but does not apply any motive power. Ships use their sublight thrusters for motive power at FTL. There are several varieties of thruster, varying in performance versus economy. All ships are equipped with arrays of hydrogen-oxygen reaction control thrusters for maneuvering. Ion drives electrically accelerate charged particles as a reaction mass. They are extremely efficient but produce negligible thrust. They are mainly used for automated cargo barges. The primary commercial engine is a fusion torch which vents the plasma of the ship's power plant. Fusion torches offer powerful acceleration at the cost of difficult heat management. Torch fuel is fairly cheap. Helium-3 skimmed from gas giants and deuterium extracted from seawater or cometary bodies. Propellant is hydrogen, likewise skimmed from gas giants. In combat, military vessels require accelerations beyond the capability of fusion torches. Warship thrusters inject antiprotons into a reaction chamber filled with hydrogen. The matter-antimatter annihilation provides unmatched motive power. The drawback is fuel production. Antiprotons must be manufactured one particle at a time. Most antimatter production is done at massive solar arrays, orbiting energetic stars, making them high-value targets in wartime. The exhaust of fusion and antiproton drives is measured in millions of degrees Celsius. Any vessel caught beyond them will melt like wax in a blowtorch. Any long-duration interstellar flight consists of two phases, acceleration and deceleration. Starships accelerate to the halfway point of their journey, then flip 180 degrees and apply thrust on the opposite vector, decelerating as they finish the trip. The engines are always operating, and peak speed is attained at the middle of the flight. Weapons, ablative armor. A warship's kinetic barriers reduce the damage from solid objects, but can do nothing to Black Guardian lasers, particle beams, and other forms of directed energy weapon. The inner layer of warship protection consists of ablative armor plate designed to boil away when heated. The vaporized armor material scatters a dew beam, rending it ineffectual. A scaffold is built around the interior pressure hull, with shields of ablative armor hung from the structure. Shields typically have multiple layers of armor, separated by empty baffles, spaces often used for cargo storage. Cruisers, which lack the internal space to fit dedicated fighter hangars, store the shipboard fighter complement in the baffles. It is not unknown for enlisted crew to build illicit alcohol distilleries in some obscure corner of the baffles, safe from prying eyes. Disruptor torpedoes. Oh, good. Two more after this. Disruptor torpedoes are powered projectiles with warheads that create random and unstable mass effect fields when triggered. These fields warp space-time in localized areas. The rapid asymmetrical mass changes cause the target to rip itself apart. In flight, torpedoes use a mass-increasing field, making them too huge for enemy kinetic barriers to repel. Because extra mass retards acceleration, torpedoes are easy prey for defensive guardian weapons and must therefore be launched at extremely close range to be effective. To prevent damage to the parent craft, torpedoes must be cold launched, meaning they are released before their thrusters ignite. Aligning with its target's trajectory, a fighter releases a torpedo and immediately thrusts away, while the torpedo continues to coast towards its target. After the fighter is clear, no more than a second after launch, the torpedo activates its mass field and thrusters away from the fighter and towards its target. Torpedoes are the main anti-ship weapon used by fighters. Launched at point-blank range in ripple-fire waves, they are reminiscent of the ancient Calliope rocket artillery launchers, thus their popular nickname, Callies. By saturating defensive guardian systems with multiple targets, at least a few torpedoes will get through. Weapons, Guardian. A ship's general area defense integration anti-spacecraft network, Guardian, consists of anti-missile, anti-fighter laser turrets on the exterior hull. Because these are under computer control, the gunnery control officer needs to do little beyond turn the system on and designate targets as hostile. Since lasers move at light speed, they cannot be dodged by anything moving at non-relativistic speeds. Unless the beam is aimed poorly, it will always hit its target. In the early stages of a battle, the Guardian fire is 100% accurate. It is not 100% lethal, but it doesn't have to be. Damaged freighters must break off for repairs. Lasers are limited by diffraction. The beam spreads out, decreasing the energy density, watts per M2, the weapon can place on a target. Any high-powered laser is a short-range weapon. Guardian networks have another limitation, heat. Weapons-grade lasers require cooldown time during which heat is transferred to sinks or radiators. As lasers fire, heat builds within them, reducing damage, range, and accuracy. Fighters attack in swarms. The first few will be hit by Guardian, but as battle continues, the effects of laser overheat, allowing the attackers to press ever closer to the ship. Constant use will burn out a laser. Guardian lasers typically operate in infrared frequencies. Shorter frequencies would offer superior stopping power and range, but degradation of local arrays and mirrors would make them expensive to maintain, and most prefer mechanical reliability over bleeding-edge performance where lives are concerned. Solarians, however, use near-ultraviolet frequency lasers with 6 times the range, believing that having additional time to shoot down incoming missiles is more important. Lasers are not blocked by the kinetic barriers of capital ships, however, the range of lasers limits their use to rare knife-fight range ship-to-ship combat. Weapons, Javelin. The Javelin is an experimental close assault weapon fitted on a handful of newer Alliance warships. It consists of a rack of 2 or more disposable disruptor torpedo tubes bolted or magnetically slung onto the exterior of a ship's armored hull. Fired on converging trajectories, the torpedoes detonate in a precisely timed sequence that allows the warhead's dark energy to resonate and thereby magnify the resulting space-time warp effects. like fighter-launched torpedoes, javelins, or cold launch for safety reasons, though they use a different approach, resembling old-fashioned submarine torpedo tubes. Javelin torpedoes come packed in individual sealed tubes filled with compressed inert gas. Opening the front of the tube causes escaping gases to push the torpedo into the vacuum, releasing a puff of crystals around the mouth of the tube. After completely clearing the tube, the torpedo ignites its thrusters. Javelin mounts are most often fitted on swift frigates which enter knife fight torpedo ranges as a matter of course. Javelins may also be fitted on heavier ships for short range engagements such as trans relay assaults. And that's it. They are particularly useful in this role for dreadnoughts, which cannot lay their main guns on close range targets. As missile weapons, javelins are subject to highly accurate defensive guardian fire. They must be launched in large numbers and at short range to have any chance of hitting their target at all. Alright, that was crazy. That was a lot of reading. Still got technology and weapons, armor, and equipment. But that will be another episode since I've been reading for about an hour. So, I basically created this episode as a way of protest of being dragged into a quest when I talk to the elusive man.
The elusive man wishes to speak to you in the debriefing room, Commander.
Yes, Callie. So next episode we will talk to the elusive man and find out just what the hell. I guess he's going to push us through the Omega 4 relay. I don't even know. In any case, that will be a much shorter episode. It'll probably be me playing the entire episode, or the entire quest, mission, assignment, whatever you choose to call it, split into between 30 to 40 minute segments. So thanks for watching. Stay tuned for that, and endure. In enduring, grow strong.